You are listening to the Retina UK online Leicestershire local peer support group meeting recorded Thursday, 18th of August, 2022.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the second online local peer support group for Leicestershire for Retina UK. My name is Mark Baxter. I'm the Information and Support Coordinator for Retina UK. I'm responsible for two services. One that will be the local peer support groups around the UK and our four nations, and also our talk and support service. I've got retinitis pigmentosa, so not only am I a member of staff for Retina UK, I'm also one of the sight loss community with an inherited retinal dystrophy as well. We have joining us this evening our group facilitator for the Leicestershire Local Peer Support Group, Sarah Ledbetter. Thanks, Sarah, for joining us, and also Tony Kerr, who will be talking about his company in a little bit more detail about outdoor activities onwards and upwards, about what they do in and around Leicestershire for outdoor sporting activities for members not only of the visually impaired and the local community as well. So with further ado, Sarah, would you like to say a few things to introduce yourself?
Yes, of course I can. Welcome everybody to the second Leicestershire Retina UK group. I'm looking forward to it, and thank you all for coming and joining this meeting. And it'll be really interesting to see what sorts of activities Tony's company offer. And I'm really interested because Chris, who doesn't, you know, hello, bless him. We have before done whitewater rafting up home pier point, so that different things, it sounded really interesting. I like to try different activities. So I thought this was a really good opportunity as we're all wanting to get more active and to try and find out what different things are out there in Leicestershire for us to take part in.
Fantastic.
Hi, Sarah. Thanks very much. Now, and we're going to pass over now to Tony Kerr to talk about Onwards and Upwards. Thank you very much for joining us this evening.
No, thank you very much for the invite. And as I've been introduced, my name's Tony Kerr, K-E-R-R. My company is Onwards and Upwards. There's information available at onwardsandupwards.com. Really honoured to be invited to come and have a chat. Mark's mentioned my company already, but I'm here less to kind of push my own services, but really just to inspire and excite you to get outside and try a few things, whether it's something you haven't done for a long time or something new that you want to give it a go. I'm hoping also to explain some of the adaptations around accessibility issues that are often create barriers to people accessing some of these activities, and hopefully ways around it that we can deal with those issues. And then I'd also like to provide a short list of activity ideas and venues and providers that where you'll be able to experience some of these activities that I want to chat about. So I'm going to start off just with a little bit about myself. I'm been an outdoor instructor now for probably about 6 years. I've had a few careers before that. I'm now 52. For any of you with severe visual impairment, I'm extremely good looking. I look much younger than my years. So it's a full head of hair, although the grey's starting to show through. And I'm currently sat in my office at home in Fleckney. I live between Leicester and Market Harborough. And my office is full of maps and planners and reference books, and my garage is full of outdoor equipment. So if I was to take you down there and let you loose, you'd be stumbling all over various bits of kit that if they're not in my van, they're lying in various piles in my garage. It's taken me a long time to come round to this new career. I've been this is my third career really, and I think the reason for that is because I've always made a specific effort to be involved in an industry that I love. originally I was I worked in theatre when I left school. I was a stage manager, technician, lighting designer, photographer. I worked in wardrobe, I worked front of house and built scenery. So I did pretty much every job in theatre over the course of 12 years. And it even appeared on stage at times and directed a few things. And I did that just simply because when I was at school, it was something I realised I really enjoyed. Until I fell out of love with it. And my second career was gardening. I got into gardening. I was mowing lawns and trimming hedges as a result of, you know, to de-stress from the theatre world where I worked hard and played hard. And then, I realised I'd been working for a long time in black boxes with no windows. You've all been to the theatre. I've been hearing the shows you've been visiting and that you're planning to visit soon. And you realise that's a lifestyle that just involves being indoors all the time. So I went from one extreme to the other and fell in love with nature. It was a lot of similar skills of managing people and building things and looking after things, and added into that the elements that I was growing, planting and maintaining gardens. And I did that 15, 16 years until that way became way too stressful. And I'd already begun to climb. And I was always a keen hiker and camper. It'd been a long time at that point since I'd been in a canoe or a kayak. But I had young kids and I was keen to get them out and get them involved. So I joined various clubs, and the longer I was with them, the more involved I got. And at some point, one of the other instructors said to me, "Hey, you'd be good at this." And it hadn't occurred to me that it was a job that I could do. So that resulted in another career change and a gathering of qualifications. It's an amazing industry. It really is limitless. And what I'm really enjoying about it is, on a personal level, is just cherry picking the activities and chasing qualifications, which involve, you know, obviously doing the activities myself, gaining experience, and then helping people to enjoy the outdoors and to experience those activities themselves. The range of activities that I currently cover include high ropes and low ropes, which was the first activity I got into. And I'll cover some of these in a little bit more detail. But from high ropes, it led me into becoming a climbing instructor. And again, various aspects of that, which I'd like to touch on. And through that, and working at an outdoor centre, I was providing bushcraft sessions for kids, taking them hiking, instructing them how to camp and looking after their safety while we were away. And I guess quite a surprise for me was I fell back in love with kayaking and canoeing. And that's become the core of my private business. As an add-on to that, just through the industry and how we operate, you know, we're dealing with groups, and there's a lot of team building and problem solving that we work on, activity days, and we do that from a corporate level down to small one-to-one sessions with people overcoming anxieties and just gaining confidence, and then introducing them to groups and starting to interact with other people and build relationships, socializing a little bit more. From a personal point of view, it ties in really well with all the things I've ever done. I feel like my previous industries, working in theatre, putting on a production, effectively being a bit of a showman, through to the design element and the client management that I learned through my horticultural industry. And now adding these new skills that I've got, it's brought me to where I was, to where I am now. To the effect that in lockdown, all my work ground to a halt. And I realized that I was in a position to create my own business rather than being an independent freelance instructor working for other providers. I realized that the only way forward for me really at that point, between the first and second lockdown, was to create a an opportunity to, for people to come and try these activities in a one-to-one and in small groups. Obviously, we had a limit of six people at once to gather between lockdowns. So the idea was that up to groups of five, I could take out and do these activities with. And thus was born Onwards and Upwards. It's proved a little bit more successful than I had anticipated. It was a bit of a stopgap for me. I was waiting for the core of my business to return, and not knowing if it was going to be a couple of weeks or a couple of months or even a couple of years before that happened. And now it's something I run alongside, operating as an instructor and a guide and a coach and a supervisor for other providers. The bulk of my year now, now that business is back to usual, is Duke of Edinburgh expeditions. So between March and October, the bulk of my time is training up and then supervising and assessing youths out on their Duke of Edinburgh hiking and camping expeditions. And I'm back for August, so you've hit me at a good time where I'm actually at home during daylight hours. And I've actually had a couple of weekends off recently. And what that's done is allow me just to make contact again with my clients, who some of whom I haven't seen since last winter. And currently during August, I'm running wellbeing sessions for the Canal and River Trust. They're social prescription sessions, running Nottingham, Market Harborough, and in the centre of Leicester. And these, again, are prescribed either by GPs or by charities, social workers, church groups, and there's a self-referral system as well, whereby people can come and get onto the water, do canoeing sessions. Really enjoying that. That's the first time I've been involved in that this year. Did a few March, April, and I've been running three days a week during August. We're looking to continue that next year. So the main thing I love about my current role is the variety. Every day I'm with a different group, different people doing different activities. It's a huge industry full of amazing people and amazing opportunities. Not just the instructors, but the people who come to us, you know, wanting to test themselves, maybe try something a little bit outside of their comfort zone and get outdoors. I've got three kids. I've got an older son, it was his birthday this week. We just went out for a meal last night. I've got a younger daughter who's 13, who I constantly worry about because she thinks she's 30 or at least 20, 25. My middle daughter is 18, Tegan. She's severely disabled. She was damaged during birth. She's severe epilepsy, cerebral palsy. She's quadriplegic and she's visually impaired. And I guess it's some of that experience with her and my own personal, you know, experiences that's led me to where I am and the target audience or the target market for my private clients. My speciality, I guess, you know, the thing I've gathered my most experience or the thing I pride myself in gathering the most amount of experience about is actually dealing with people's anxieties. It's not easy for some people just out of the house, you know, and or to book themselves onto an activity that they might not have tried before, or maybe they've had a bad experience with previously. So it's my role with a lot of my clients, just firstly to get them on site, explain how things work, reassure them, provide all the safety, build some trust. And all of that allows them just to actually either get on the water or to give climbing a go or to, you know, to trust me to take them out guiding on a trip, whether that be for one day or for you know, 4 or 5 day expedition. There are huge areas which I realize I'm not very experienced at. And I have quite a wide range of client base. Visual impairment and sight loss is not something I have a huge experience with. But I'm also aware that there's a huge range of conditions out there that I that I am dealing with. But every time I meet somebody, they're an individual and it's their experience actually that they bring to the session and I'm guided by them. As coaches, we're trained into coaching sessions that are learner-centric. So everything I do is about the learner. The participant dictates the session to me. So whether it's choice of venue or the equipment that we're using or how the session is run, how long it is. Sometimes I run 15, 20 minute sessions with people who suffer from exhaustion or sudden bouts of tiredness, right through to somebody who's hugely ambitious, but they just need a little bit of help with either an adaptation with an equipment or a change of venue or a particular time of day, and once I'm able to provide those small changes to what I do, they're able to run with it and the session will be the same as any other session I run. So I think that's my fundamental point, is that it's from you as participants that are going to guide me how best to help you. So all my experience with all my other clients isn't going to enable me to provide the perfect session for you. It's you that's going to be able to do that. And that comes through communication, something I've learned in my previous industries. I used to design and build gardens, huge gardens. And I've always said it's not a garden for them. It's not a garden for me. It's a garden for them. It's them that has to enjoy that. And that comes through communication and being able to empathize and understand your situation. It's regardless of whether I'm dealing with somebody with a physical disability or a young person. I deal with a lot of school refusers, a lot of people with behavioural issues and ADHD, for example, and autism. It's less about those conditions. It's often more about the anxiety, not being sure what it is that they're signing up to, not quite understanding the activity itself and how easy it can be to make it accessible for them. So it's and again, I'm just applying that understanding constantly to whoever rocks up. It's all things are possible. I don't see anything as not being possible. I think my most inspiring interaction with visual impairment in my industry was that I witnessed a paraclimbing event. So these are climbing athletes who either amputees, or visual impairments, and I was really hugely inspired by the accessibility that's possible, the adaptations that were made, and how huge the determination of the participants needed to be back then at that stage in order to achieve some of these things that a lot of people take for granted, obviously. And again, I assume this is something that you have very good experience with. The adaptations for the visually impaired and sight loss categories were that they had earpieces connected to a coach, and the coach was kind of guiding them up the wall. So they were climbing huge climbing walls with harnesses and ropes, but with an earpiece connected to somebody who's down on the floor, able to see the route in the same way that you might be with somebody just saying to you, "Oh, mind the step, or we're going to turn left here." So it's that opened a new world for me, realizing that actually there's a lot that's possible. Just to jump back a little bit, I just want to define some of these different activities, just so that you've got an understanding of what's out there and what's possible. First thing I mentioned was high ropes. These are generally built generally custom built premises. They're towers connected with rails and hoist systems and all sorts that there can be best described as an assault course or challenges at height. So again, with harnesses and ropes and with instructor supervision. low ropes is a similar thing, but it's obviously much lower. And this can be a foot to a foot and a half off the ground. And we run sessions for a huge variety of participants that where you're either operating individually or as a team. Some of the challenges are mental puzzles, some of them are physical challenges, which require strength and dexterity. And a lot of them are reliant on helping each other. So that you might be working your way around an obstacle course that requires each other, everybody to be helping each other. Climbing, again, maybe you've witnessed some of this or experienced some of this, but I would split the climbing activities we do into two categories. One would be roped, so we're operating at height, again, with harnesses and ropes. And the other is bouldering, which is a form of climbing, which is much low level, akin to scrambling, if that's something you've done or witnessed, where you're using your hands and your feet just to problem solve routes up and over short boulders or rock surfaces. Touched on hiking, it's my qualifications as a mountain leader can take me to some quite extreme environments. But again, it needs to be suited to the participants. So whether we're crossing a ridge with a severe drop on either side, or we're out for a leisurely walk along a canal, I guide walks for participants that are suited to their abilities and their ambitions. Again, my daughter being in a wheelchair has taught me that to plan. So my adaptation for her really is about location. So I would choose a venue that's wheelchair friendly, obviously. Not everywhere is. So it's starting to look at different adaptations within that, which I do for any participant. It all starts from the initial chat that we have about their confidence level and what it is they're trying to achieve. From there, I'm also part of my work is instructing people on campcraft. So whether you've been camping or not, there's always room for improvement. Some people, I deal with inner city kids who have never stepped outside their city, never been in a field, never been able to appreciate touching a horse or running from a cow or we took a group from an inner city school in Birmingham recently, and I was very aware that they hadn't been outside. What I hadn't realized when we arrived at the campsite was that there were alpacas and llamas on site, and some of these kids had never even heard of these animals, let alone stood close, fed them and touched them. So it's it's about just extending people's experiences, really. So whether we're wild camping on a ridge in North Wales or in a hollow at the back of a mountain in the Lake District, or we're just outside Stourbridge on a flat, easy access site, tailor making these experiences to the participants. Leading on from campcraft is an activity which is gaining in popularity, which is a really general term, bushcraft. And that covers a whole wide range of activities, including survival skills and shelter building. Often an easy entry point for some of the participants I deal with is fire building. So we're learning about the use and creation of fire and the control of it, gathering suitable fuels, using different materials to try and start fires, and then obviously monitoring that and using that fire, not just for warmth, but for cooking food. And so there's a food preparation and cooking aspect to that also. Within paddle sports, there are three main thrusts to what I do. One is what I've been doing with these wellbeing sessions recently. They're easily accessible canoes, Canadian open canoes. Classically, carved from a tree log, so a tree trunk. So we climb down into these, and generally as beginners, I'm teaching that in as tandem, so there's a pair of participants in each boat. And then once they've gained those skills and working together well, I'll transfer that into a solo canoe, which is a harder thing to control. So it's quite a technical craft to paddle. And the benefit of a canoe is that you can fit a tent in it or two, carry all your kit in dry bags. And I tend to use those for longer expeditions if we're paddling for 2 or 3 days. Kayaks, where we sit inside, they relate back to an old fashioned kayak, which was crafted out of a skin covering a frame, went through a fiberglass stage. I remember the smell from in the 70s and 80s when I was a kid. And they're now made from much lighter resins, hard wearing, almost like bumper cars on the water. When you see 120 kids all climb into kayaks, you'd think they're bumper cars, because that's pretty much all they're doing is bumping into each other. Sitting much lower into the water, and you have a paddle with two blades on either end, and it's a much easier craft to for beginners, I'd say. It's not easy to go in a straight line to start with. Once you've nailed that, then it's more about the environment. I use my kayak on wild water, so it's much faster rivers, rapids, and a lot of froth. And at that stage, it becomes a much more technical craft to paddle. Stand-up paddle boards are all the rage. The country sold out of paddle boards last year. There was at one point there was a seven month waiting list from for some of the bigger manufacturers last year. Became very common in lockdown or between lockdowns. I know Lidl was selling one for £200. I think they've still got a few. So it's very easy access. There's a safety aspect. Obviously, if you buy a boat and just throw yourself on the water, not necessarily getting the training you require. So I've even seen this morning, I've seen somebody out on his paddleboard. No buoyancy aid, no shoes. And I wouldn't recommend that on the canals around Leicester at all. And then, again, it's a suck it and see thing, really. There's a level of just being on the water with all these craft. Being on the water, the longer you're on the water, the easier it gets. I highly recommend using a coach or an instructor just to get you started, because otherwise we're reinventing the wheel on a lot of these things, and actually make life a lot easier with a little bit of instruction at least. What else can I tell you? That's probably with regards to the activities that I personally run. That's probably it. If there's other ideas, I know that Sarah mentioned before I started some gill scrambling. So they're variations on a theme. So we're effectively working our way up a path through a stream uphill. There's a bit of scrambling, bit of walking, and a lot of splashing around. So those are pretty much my activities. With regards to specific visual impairment and sight loss accessibility, there's a few things I'm aware of that are out of my hands, such as the marketing for providers. So making that, I think that could definitely be improved. It's something I've probably not taken enough consideration or taken into consideration enough myself. And then also there's a transport aspect. A lot of these activities don't take place around the corner or at the end of your road, but some of them do. So it's not necessarily about traveling to the end of the country. But again, you know better than I do what your requirements are. And with a discussion beforehand, you know, I'm sure there's very little that can't be resolved if we have an understanding of what your requirements are. A lot of venues and providers are much better than they used to be, certainly in the last 5 to 10 years, I'd say, with regards to venue adaptations. So making things accessible for those with physical and mental disabilities. And also equipment adaptations. So with regards to craft on the water in particular, getting in and out and then being able to paddle. Activity adaptations is the next aspect, and hopefully I've covered a few of those already. I think that's my speciality, and not because I have huge range of experience that covers absolutely everybody's situation, but more because I'm open to listening and understanding what your needs are and how you've resolved other activities possibly. Coaching and guiding adaptations, again, I've commented on, that's standard. That's what I do. Okay. So if we need a little bit of time on something, or we need less time on another aspect, all dynamic. What I want to do is drag you outside, really. You know, it's all well and good sitting and chatting about this for half an hour on a Zoom call. But really, it's the experience of getting outside and doing it that's going to give you the bug and make you keep coming back and try other things, hopefully. I often use blindfolds in my sessions. It's an aspect of coaching which I found really useful. It heightens other people's sensory perceptions of what they're doing. I often use it when people are working in teams as well. So I'll have a guide and I'll have a blindfolded person who's receiving instructions about how they, you know, the next step to take or the next climbing hole to use. Okay. And I'm aware through that those other, we're focusing on those other senses. And I think there's a lot of attention paid to touch and to smell and hearing. But even just the wind on our face, when I was outside today with a little bit of a breeze, I'm very aware of that. And as I climb up over a hill, reach the summit, I know I've arrived because of that increase in wind that's suddenly on my face. Obviously, the smell of the area I'm in. Tuesday was an awful, awful smell all day. I discovered a refuse bin from a pub had been thrown, tipped into the canal, and the canals don't smell the best, smell very good at the best of time. But these bags of rubbish had all spilled and opened. I was trying to remove some of them, and as a result, you wouldn't have wanted to give me a hug at the end of that session because I absolutely stunk. But generally, most of my activities, most of the places I'm going, it's a really rich smell. You know, I'm surrounded by flowers, cow dung. It's teenagers. You know, I'm very aware. It's a really intense part of what I do. The sounds of being outside. I'm really appreciative of the bird call. And the wildlife, and again the wind in my ears. Temperature, we've been experiencing a heat wave, but whether it's super hot or super cold, I love being outside. I find that really stimulating. Either way, there's no such thing as bad weather. Only bad preparation and bad clothing. So we spoke with Mark earlier. He's looking to invest in a dry suit, and the beauty of that is you can fall in the water. And but underneath your dry suit, which is sealed piece of clothing, doesn't let the water in. You can wear as many layers under there as possible. And I paddle in December, January with thermals, thick trousers, and a woolly jumper underneath my dry suit, and of course a woolly hat. But again, it's that thrill of that sensation of being in cold water, which I have one particular client that was her thing. She was desperate to fall out of her kayak and experience the cold water. the hormones that fly around us. You know, that's I feel that's an extraordinary sense that's probably not acknowledged enough. So the adrenaline of just of putting ourselves in a place where we have that that slight sense of fear, but also excitement. Those endorphins that we get as a rush when we when we've achieved something and we're feeling good about where we are and what we've done. Also the inner peace and the calm I get from being on a wild camping site, just me up on a hill, or paddling down a gentle river, knowing that I'm the first one out there that day, can't hear any traffic, don't have to go any further if I don't want to. Pull up and have a break on a bank, knowing that there's no footpath, there's nobody venturing near. And again, I think it's that that pride I take in myself every time I achieve something. It's that sense of achievement that really gets me out every time. When I'm lying in bed, struggling for motivation, and it's the memories of where I was the day before, the year before, that feeling of being at the top of the mountain or getting back down safely to the car park, and thinking my day through at the end of the day. I spend a lot of time trying to be mindful and processing my experiences because they fly by otherwise. As I said at the beginning of this, every day for me is different. I'm in a different location, different part of the country, different group of people, different challenges, different activity. And I find slowing certain parts of my day down and just appreciating that probably the most rewarding aspect. And as far as I'm concerned, that last list that I've given you there, there's no reason that visual impairment or sight loss would prevent you from sensing any of those other feelings. Very aware of time. Mark said to me, 20 minutes, half an hour. Sure. So I know we started a little bit late, but I'm happy to take questions. And also I know that there's probably a little bit of chat back and forth, and you've all got experiences as well, which I know you've been out there and done stuff, which I'm looking forward to hearing about as well.
That was truly inspirational, Tony. I was like mesmerized by it. And I've done fundraising in the past, as many of the group here tonight have done these outdoors acts. And I think we can all probably just sit back and to relate to at least one of those things that you've actually said, the sights, sorry, the smells, you know, whether it's the dew and the unzipping your tent for the first time on a field that's covered in dew, you know, that takes me back, 30 years, and it's still, still exactly the same smell, it hasn't changed in three decades, and it's like, it just takes you back to your childhood when you used to do the camping, the holidays, the staycations, and stuff like that. Just the cold on your face, the warmth on your face, and I think we can all relate to that. So thank you very much for sharing some of your experiences, because I found that very, very moving and very motivational. Has anybody got any questions for Tony about anything that he's spoken about this evening?
Go on, Mitch.
I was just saying, with me, because I am totally blind, I don't see anything. I was very interested in the low ropes and the low climbing to solve, because I've not done much because with the syndrome that myself and Rach and Sarah got, I suffer with fatigue if I do too much in a short space of time. So I was very interested just to know a bit more about the low ropes and the low like climb you were talking about.
So I'll start with the low ropes. So there's a variety of activities that fall into this category, and they're generally used as team building activities or personal challenges. They often revolve around puzzle solving, and there's usually a physical element to them as well. So, for example, if you can imagine a tree trunk with a support in the middle of the tree trunk, so it's acting as a seesaw. As a warm-up, I might take a group of people, whether that's 5 or 9 or 15 people, and get them either to sit or to stand on either end of this seesaw, and as a group they need to position themselves so that they're balanced. So there's ways of providing handheld support. The activity takes place probably 8 inches off the ground, but it's a team challenge to try and balance this seesaw with a varied number of people on each side. You might have to shuffle in a little bit. You might want to swap members around, so we've got somebody a bit bigger towards the middle, or you might want to put 3 people on this side and only 2 on that. There are low level miniature how do I describe this? It's a walkway, I guess, and there'll be a range of elements within this walkway. Some of them will be a balancing act, so you might be walking along a piece of rope with a piece of rope as a handrail. You might be balancing along a wooden log again. It might be a rope bridge or a plank bridge. There are elements that you need to work together to move, so that there might be a swing or a low level short zip wire kind of apparatus, like a button lift almost, if you understand that, which again, once you've gone one way, you then got to get that back. So as a team, you need to operate these things so that we can get the whole team around the course. And there's I've probably touched on 2 or 3 versions of that, but there's a couple of centres that I'm thinking of where there's probably 10 or 12 different activities that all take place about a foot off the ground. And some of these activities, as I mentioned earlier, I'll run them with blindfolded participants, so that they're relying on their own senses. With regards to the climb, so you mentioned the low climb. There's an element called traversing that I would highly recommend, which is a low level climb moving sideways. So you're not going up. Okay. The problem with going up with a visual impairment or a sight loss, I would say, is that when it's time to come down, the most common way to come down for participants without visual impairment or sight loss is to let go and jump down. So there's a maximum of 4 meters on these walls generally. So if you were, if you're 1.5 meters or 1.8 meters, 6 foot tall, you're dropping down a couple of meters from the top of the wall, and it's gauging when you're about to land, I would say, is a difficult thing or a problem I've had with blindfolded participants. Okay. But what I have run is sessions where you're only a foot off the ground and you move from right to left or from left to right, rather than going up. And I think that's a good introductory place to get used to supporting your own weight on your hands and feet on a wall. And that can be enough of a challenge. And then, and we play games obviously to hunt for the hold. So there are brightly colored handholds arranged on the wall in a pattern that make it a puzzle, a challenge to move from one hold to another. Does that answer your question, Rich?
It does. Thank you. I'm very, very interested in having a go. It's just nowhere to go to do. But that's very helpful. Thank you.
This, because I'm aware of time, also that I'm going to provide a list of recommended venues and providers to Mark, and he'll circulate that. Hopefully, I'll have my details on that. If I run 1-to-1 and small group sessions, but there are other providers who, for low ropes, for example, I don't have this set up in my back garden. Okay, there are other venues that I work for, and I'm happy to provide their details and you directly with them, explain the visual impairment or sight loss situation, and they'll make adaptations and greet you and provide you with an instructor who's competent and experienced it with that.
That's brilliant. Thanks, Tony. What we'll do is we will send out a follow-up email for tonight's meeting, and any information that Tony can share with lists of organisations that can support people with visual impairments sort of in and around the UK. And we'll also put British Blind Sport on there as well, because I know they have an outdoor section where you can go and do these types of activities as well. Rachel, did you have a question as well?
So I've just got two things. One of the questions is, when you do the activities, do you sort of provide all your equipment and stuff like that? And then the second one is, I'm the opposite to Rich, even though I've got the same condition. I'm a bit of an adrenaline junkie. So I've been on the Galloway Society for the Blind Holidays, where you do the windsurfing, the kayak, the canoeing, climbing, scrambling up the crags and abseiling back down. And I'm actually going on a vision adventure holiday at the end of September.
Amazing.
I get to try open water swimming, caving, canoeing, cycling, walking, you name it. It's only Friday to Monday, but really, really looking forward to it. So it's just, I think you've already said you're going to provide a list of where you do the activities, but do you provide all the equipment and everything when you do the activities?
Yes, so all equipment is provided. If you were to come on a hike with me, then I'd expect you to bring your own suitable footwear and a day bag or a rucksack if it was an overnight thing. I'm able to provide a few rucksacks and tents and things if we were going on an overnight expedition. But appropriate clothing and footwear is probably all I'd expect you to bring. Same with being on the water. You know, you want to be dressed appropriately. And before an activity, I send out a list of appropriate clothing and footwear that you would need to bring with you. But with regards to boats, paddles, buoyancy aids, climbing harnesses, ropes, belay devices, that's my job. And either I or the centre would be providing that, depending on the activity you've chosen.
Right, and do you provide things like wetsuits and stuff like that, or?
I can do, and some centres will do. So again, it depends on the activity and the location. So, but yes, generally all equipment is provided. Some of my clients have purchased their own. They've got the bug early, and they've either bought their own wetsuit because they know it's going to fit better, or they bought a dry suit because they want to be, you know, warmer. They might buy a boat more suited to them on a volume or a construction side of things that's more suitable for, you know, their body shape or their type of paddling that they want to do. It might just simply be their favorite color.
It's a bit like, for instance, when you do the gill scrambling. I actually bought myself a wide, because of the syndrome, I've got wide feet. So I actually bought my own wellies that I take with me when I go on it now, because their wellies are really long and really tight. So I sort of just purchased them with me going a few times. So things
fantastic.
Like that.
Meeting you through Retina UK, there's no way that I would know that, is that? So it's only through that conversation. Brilliant. It's not a side effect.
That's my problem. I can't get Wellingtons to fit my feet.
Gosh.
No, you'd laugh at me when I've got wellies on, because having small, very small, I've got for my kids, but wide, they just like run, do a concertina at the back, so they don't fit me very well at all. So I go a sort of different type of shoe, because I just don't do wellies at all, really. You'll have to laugh if I wear wellies.
That's why I got the wide fit ones there, because they're small. Mine are only a size 4, but they're really wide, so... with Rich, because he's 6'4", and what are you, Rich, size 13'2", getting wellies is just a bit of a nightmare.
Difficult, very difficult, I'd say.
And just tell me, did wellies end up full of water anyway?
They did with the gill scrambling, they came off.
Yeah, so I wouldn't necessarily recommend wellies for gill scrambling, but, even an old pair of trainers or a decent pair of walking boots, because it's more about the friction on the bottom, and wellies aren't always very good at that.
Me, it'd be a good pair of Doc Martens.
It's Chris, could I just come in and just say something? The thing that I've really, really enjoyed about this is the fact that you've openly admitted that you don't really know a great deal about visually impairment, but you've been quite open to come on here and sort of say, you know, you'd be prepared to sort of learn as you go along, and it's that's how it goes, isn't it? You know, you're quite open to that because I'm definitely
wear my heart on my sleeve. I'm wearing my logo on my sleeve, actually. I'm just I don't mince my words. I'm not here to fool anybody or to drag you in, even. I'm stating things how they are. I'm hugely impressed, as I say, when I watched the paraclimbing team and the visual impairment guys. I was blown away with you know, their determination and the adaptations that were made in order for them to achieve exactly what everybody else in the team was achieving. My limited experience through my own daughter's visual impairment has given me a little bit of insight into that. But my real expertise is overcoming anxiety and lack of awareness, maybe, of what's possible, and then turning that into a possible. Mm-hmm. And that takes time, it takes conversation, mm-hmm. takes empathy and understanding. Mm-hmm. And I don't see visual impairment or sight loss as any different in that respect, to be honest. And forgive me if I'm speaking turn, but that's...
We yeah. as a group and some of others, we don't feel the, how do we put this, feel the norm as what visually impaired and blind people should do. Like, say, me and Chris, we did, in memory of a friend, we did home pier point doing white water rafting.
Yeah,
and okay. And we try to do, like with Rachel, I've done one before, the water park week or stuff like that. It's just like you said, which is wonderful to hear. It's that awareness and saying, giving us the confidence of what we can achieve and what we can do, which is sometimes is not an officer's, because you're visually impaired, you're blind, or there's no way you can do this.
That's what I like about the water parks there, because they're a bit like Tony in the fact that.
Exactly.
Theirs isn't for visually impaired people. They've learned by their instructors asking the questions like you're doing of what support do you need? How can I help you? What's the best way to help you and support you? And that's what they've done.
Yeah.
And from what you're telling us here, it sounds amazing.
It does sound amazing. It does definitely.
I mean, I have done various levels of disability awareness. Both climbing within my climbing qualifications and on the water with British canoeing, and I think that's my biggest takeaway from those that I've been doing over the years is just, you know, you're the experts. Why would I tell you what my adaptations are going to be?
Well, for us, it's give us the dates, tell us where you are, both me and Sarah. And
excuse
me, Rach, don't leave me out.
Oh, sorry, we do apologise, Richard. Because I did try climbing up a wall in Ambleside in the Lake District, and like you said, and because you're going up high, it's that sort of thing of coming down. But the only problem was we had to attach our Kiki, who's the retired one, on a sandbank, but she tried to pull it over the thing. Anyway, but it was that I'm not got no problems with height because I jumped out of a plane at 13,000 feet, tandem skydiving. But it was that leaning back and putting your trust in somebody to lean back and come down and then say, yes you're near the floor, yes, you've got to not go on your bum sort of thing. But that going sideways does appeal to me, I must admit.
Well, I remember when we done that wall climbing at Ambleside. And the bloke was surprised that we would go up as high as we did. Because he said most people that go in see the height of it and it puts them off straight away. Mm. But he then said perhaps the way you looked at it was because when we were at the top, we couldn't visualise the bottom.
No.
The fear wasn't there. So because he was trying to get us to go up by move your arm to the right, up a bit to the side, and then somebody said, just do it by the clock face. So put your feet at, put your hand at 9 o'clock, your leg at 6 o'clock, and move up like that. And we all started going up and down. And he just said, well, I've learned something today because I would never have done it like that. You know, he didn't understand how a clock face could help. He thought he was helping somebody how he would normally tell them to do, move your foot up, move your arm up. But once we started using the clock face, it was just up and down, up and down, because it was just
much easier to find
what you're used to.
Yeah.
Your way of doing it.
No, that's good.
I can see, Rachel, I've got an epiphany. I think for maybe one of your in-person groups, or go on kind of an activity day or something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't know how that would sound to everyone. I know we're coming we'll be coming into the winter months soon, but it could be something that we could look to help arrange if Tony's interested in working with the visually impaired community a lot more. Then it could be something that we can perhaps put together in the summer, you know,
out and about
and outside, rather than in a meeting room, or if the outdoors is where you guys shine, then it's something that we can certainly help arrange for you guys, get a bit of fresh air.
Just 2 seconds, Mark. Nelly, you didn't hear the word of water.
What?
No, she did not hear the word water.
I just better explain to Tony, that's my new guide dog, who actually is a golden retriever and does love water.
Oh, wow. Overexcited already.
I'd
be very happy to do that, Mark, and need to plan ahead and make sure that we're choosing the right activity. But yes, definitely.
That'd be amazing. Thank you.
For myself, it'd be good, because if it was just like a one day thing, I'd be able to manage that. It's just when he's outdoor activities are like over like 3 or 4 days, it'd be too much.
Yeah, no, that's understandable. And I run 90 minute sessions as a taster generally. We do half day tours and journeys on the water. Or we'll do a whole day, you know, traveling down a river or going off somewhere, you know, a bit further away to do a hike. But no, it's made to measure. And I've said, I've even run 20 minute sessions for people who are struggling with.
That's good then. Yeah.
It's all about confidence building, isn't it? It's like the first time I went with the Galloway Society, and they took us out with the paddleboard and showed us the windsurfer. And she said, by the end of the week, you'll be up on that board standing. I was like, yeah, of course. And you know what? She was right. By the end of the week, I did stand up and I did fall in a few times.
Yeah.
But it's the confidence of actually knowing yourself, what you can and you can't do, and the barriers, and the fact that you can do anything if you put your mind to it.
Completely.
And
I say with paddleboarding that if you don't fall in, you're not trying.
Yeah.
It's almost compulsory. And my top tip for paddleboarding would be fall in early and fall in lots.
Yeah.
And so you're going to get a much better experience out of it.
Fantastic.
I'm looking forward to it. Four weeks to go, and then we're going to be exploring as many lakes in the Cotswolds as I can. So, yeah, I can't actually wait. Like I said to the guys, I bought my brand new life jacket, and I've got my water shoes. Just going to get my wetsuit now, and I've even got waterproof walkie talkies. You know, so we can keep in contact with those on the wives on land who don't want to get in the boats, but me and my friends, you know, we love being out on the water. So
that sounds amazing, Mark.
Looking
sounds good. And I'll let you know how I get on at the Vision Adventure.
You've already all got some adventures lined up already. That's fantastic.
No, we love the outdoors. This group, we all love the outdoors, you know. For me, from a fundraising point of view, for Retina UK over the years, you know, it's led me to be enjoying more of the outdoors than be stuck indoors, you know. Mm-hmm. And meeting these guys, you know, it's made me appreciate the outdoors so much more, you know. And can't wait to meet you guys when we come up to Manchester in December. So I'm really looking forward to that. So.
Fantastic.
It's time is now 8:10. We've taken enough of Tony's time this evening, which we really appreciate you coming on and talking about the amazing things that you've done in your career, and you know, the amazing activities that you've put on for so many people. It's been truly inspirational, and we all can't wait to get out and try them all.
Yeah, thank you ever so much for talking to us all, and it's like you say, it's inspirational. It's really great to actually find those things out there you can take part in, because before you just didn't know what was out there and where to do it and who would help you if you'd out and about, sort of thing.
Fantastic. Thank you very much for having me. And I will follow up with a list of venues and providers and maybe a little bit more inspiration for you to follow up your own research and encourage you to get out a bit more.
Mm-hmm. That'd be lovely. Thank you.
Yeah, definitely.
One thing from Retina UK, if anyone does want to learn more about obviously the activities, and they can contact us at Retina UK. You can jump onto our website, www.retinauk.org.uk, or you can call us in the office on 01 280 821 334, or email services@retinauk.org.uk or info@retinauk.org.uk. And any questions that you have in regards to any of the content this evening, it will come through to myself, and I'll be able to forward that back over to Tony, and he can answer your questions or for any other information you might like to receive. One thing he mentioned was bouldering, and if anybody's interested in learning any more about bouldering, we will be joined by our Kent group facilitator, Lucy Franks, on the 28th of September, who will be talking about her love for bouldering and how it got her through her sight loss journey, and how it gave her the confidence to climb walls and rock climb in her local climbing centre in Maidstone, Kent. So that's something you're interested in knowing a little bit more about, then join us for that one. Will be 7 p.m. on the 28th of September, and more details will follow on our website. So if you're interested in it, let us know and I can sign you up to that one as well. If anyone's got any final questions for Tony, we can adjourn the meeting now, and we can go about the rest of our evenings, which you can enjoy. Hopefully everyone's had their dinner, or you can go and grab something to eat. I'm sure we're all getting quite hungry. So thank you very, very much for coming along, Tony, for your talk. And thanks, Sarah, for facilitating a great meeting. And I wish everyone a happy and wonderful evening. Thank you so much. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye, everyone. Bye.
We hope you have enjoyed this recording. If you have any questions, queries, or wish to leave any feedback, then please leave it in the comment section below. Alternatively, you can send your inquiries to info@retinauk.org.uk. Contact us via the telephone on 01280 821 334 or call our helpline on 0300 111 4000, which is open Monday to Friday 9:30 a.m. to 9:30 p.m. If you would like to know more about our local peer groups, when your next meeting will be held, or if you wish to get involved in creating your own group, or would like to know more about our services that Retina UK provides, then please visit our information and support page on our website, www.retinauk.org.uk, and navigate to our local peer group page. Thanks again for listening. We hope to see you again soon. Take care. And bye for now.